In our recent video, we've talked about every possible way to emulate PS3 games on Android, and none of them were truly native. But finally, a native PS3 emulator is here. It's called a PS3 emulator. Yeah, not the most creative name, but hey, it gets the job done. It actually runs some PS3 games natively. However, there's a catch. Actually, a whole lot of drama surrounding it, but we'll get into that later. First, let me quickly show you how to set it up.
Without wasting any time, let's start. Download the APK of the emulator, which I provided in the pinned comment. Grab the official PS3 firmware from Sony's website, which I also provided in the pinned comment. Install the APK, tap the three dots, and install the firmware. Once that's done, you're ready to add games. The emulator supports ISO and PKG formats. After adding a game, make sure to refresh the library so it appears. There are no in-app settings yet, but you can tweak them manually. 1. Go to File Manager, APS3, Config. 2. Rename the config file to .txt format. 3. Open it in a text editor and adjust settings like resolution scaling, accuracy, aspect ratio, and more. 4. Once you're done tweaking, rename it back from .txt to .yml. I assume future updates will add in-app settings, and when that happens, I'll make a proper settings guide video. Some PS3 games, like Shovel Knight, require a wrap file to work. If you have a wrap file for a game, follow these steps. 1. Copy the wrap file from your storage. 2. Navigate to File Manager APS3, Config, Dev HDD0, Home 601. 3. Open the XData folder and paste the wrap file there. Now, let's talk about the games I managed to run. This time, I focused on lighter games, unlike my previous test with Olympus PS3, where I attempted more demanding titles. My goal was to see how well this emulator could handle simpler PS3 games, and whether it showed signs of improvement over previous attempts. The first game I tested was Limbo, which initially ran flawlessly with no graphical problems or slowdowns. It seemed to work just fine, but when I closed the game and tried running it again, I encountered a strange, transparent, object-like graphical issue. I don't know what caused it, but it suggests that if you want to play the game properly, you might have to complete it in a single sitting. This inconsistency highlights one of the biggest issues with early-stage emulation. Even when something works once, it may not work the next time. Because of that, I don't recommend this emulator yet, as it's still in the very early stages. Next, I tried Shovel Knight, which initially didn't run at all. However, as I mentioned earlier, Shovel Knight requires wrap files to work properly. After applying the necessary wrap file, the game ran flawlessly, with no graphical glitches, performance issues, or crashes. This was a promising result, as it showed that the emulator is capable of running some 2D games correctly, provided they have the necessary decryption files. Sonic CD also ran without any issues, playing perfectly smoothly with no graphical bugs. The same was true for Mega Man 10, which worked just as well as on real hardware. Seeing these games run so well gave me hope that the emulator could handle more lightweight titles with minimal problems. Encouraged by the smooth performance of these smaller games, I decided to test some other lightweight titles. Unfortunately, that's when I ran into my first major roadblock, Fat Princess. This game didn't boot at all, no matter what settings I used. It also failed to run on Olympus PS3, meaning that both emulators seemed to struggle with it. The same issue happened with Scott Pilgrim vs. the World, Castlevania, Harmony of Despair, and Pac-Man Museum. None of these games were playable. Pac-Man Museum was the only one that at least booted, but it suffered from severe graphical corruption during the intro. After that, it crashed completely, making it just as unplayable as the others. 3D.GameHeroes, on the other hand, did run after tweaking settings, but it suffered from severe graphical issues and crashed shortly afterward. That said, it still managed to get further than Pac-Man Museum, which is something, at least. While some games were completely unplayable, others were technically playable, but had noticeable graphical problems that could affect the experience. Castle Crashers ran smoothly, but the character models had graphical issues. Despite this, the game never crashed, meaning that if you don't mind visual glitches, you could still play through it. Puyo Puyo Tetris and DuckTales Remastered were in a similar situation. Both games played at full speed, but suffered from persistent graphical issues. I tried adjusting various settings to fix them, but nothing worked. Aquapazza was another game that ran well but had graphical corruption in the background. If you can ignore the broken backgrounds, the game itself is fully playable. The King of Fighters also had similar graphical issues, but in some specific locations, the game crashed outright. Bleach: Soul Resurrection was the worst of them all. It had severe graphical corruption and unplayable FPS, even after I spent a lot of time tweaking settings. Interestingly, I've seen others play this game without any major issues, so it's possible that this comes down to device differences rather than the emulator itself. Lastly, I tested Jet Set Radio, which had no graphical glitches, but its FPS was unstable. This suggests that the emulator can run it, but a more powerful device would likely be needed to achieve a consistent frame rate. I actually tested a lot more games, but I wanted to highlight these ones specifically since they give a good idea of the emulator's current state. Based on my tests, 2D and lightweight games seem to have the best chance of running, though some require additional files, like wraps. However, more complex or demanding titles often fail to boot, suffer from graphical corruption, or crash. This emulator is still far from being ready for serious gaming, but considering how early in development it is, the fact that any games are running at all is still impressive. There's potential here, but a lot of work still needs to be done before we see stable PS3 emulation on Android. Now, I already told you how to access the settings, but I get why some of you might hesitate to tweak them. Unlike most emulators with an easy-to-use settings menu, this one requires you to edit a config file in a notepad. But don't worry, it works just like any other emulator settings, just in text format. I'll go over some settings that help me, but I won't cover everything in detail yet. Once this emulator becomes more stable, I'll make a proper settings guide. Also, I won't be explaining accuracy settings since they didn't work for me. That could be because the emulator is still in an early stage or simply because my device isn't powerful enough, I'm not sure. Anyway, let's get started. Recompiler. This setting affects how the emulator processes game instructions. Right now, it doesn't seem to be working properly, so I won't go too deep into it. However, I noticed that some games require switching between LLVM and static to work. The problem is, I'm not entirely sure which games need static, so the safest approach is keep it on LLVM as long as the game runs fine. If a game doesn't work with LLVM, try switching it to static. Once the emulator is more stable, I'll test this setting properly and give you a more detailed guide. API. If you've watched my other videos, you already know this, but for those who don't, the API setting determines how the emulator renders graphics, and you should switch between OpenGL and Vulkan depending on your device. Low-end and older devices should stick to OpenGL since it's more stable. Newer devices should use Vulkan for better performance. If a game isn't running properly, try switching between the two. Sometimes Vulkan doesn't perform well on certain games, even on high-end devices, and the same goes for OpenGL. A future update might force a specific API per game, but for now, it's best to experiment. Next, we'll talk about Lana Rhodes. No kidding. If you want better visual quality, the video might start buffering or lagging. That's exactly how resolution works in emulation. Lowering it improves performance, while increasing it enhances visuals. If a game runs too slowly, reduce the resolution. If a game runs smoothly, you can try increasing it for better graphics. Right now, the emulator doesn't support many demanding PS3 games, but it's always worth testing. You never know when a game that didn't work before suddenly becomes playable. Frame skipping. If you've ever used PPSSPP, this will feel familiar. Frame skipping can boost performance by reducing the number of frames rendered per second. If a game is running slow, try enabling frame skip. Just be aware that it can make gameplay feel choppy, so use it only if absolutely necessary. It's a nice option to have, especially at this early stage of development. Resolution scale. This setting works somewhat similarly to the Lana Rhodes settings. Let's say your resolution is set to 480p, and you want better performance without lowering it to 360p. This is where resolution scaling comes in. You're probably familiar with standard resolutions like 240p, 360p, 480p, and 720p, but in reality, the rendering resolution isn't limited to just these. Instead of being locked to fixed steps, resolution scaling lets you adjust the internal rendering resolution as a percentage of your chosen resolution. Think of it like numbers. In school, we learn whole numbers, 1, 2, 3, 4, but later we realize there are infinite values in between, like 1.2, 1.02, or 1.999. Similarly, resolution scaling allows the game to render at percentages like 50% or 80% of 480p, or even 30% of 720p, giving you many more possible combinations instead of just switching between fixed resolutions. I know this setting might seem kind of pointless, like it doesn't let you pick an exact custom resolution, but it gives you extra options for tweaking, which is my favorite thing about emulators. Performance overlay. I almost forgot to mention this one, but it's probably the most important setting for testing. This lets you monitor performance in real time. Things like FPS, CPU usage, and GPU load. If an emulator doesn't have a built-in performance monitor, most testers don't even bother because external tools aren't always accurate. So if you're experimenting with different settings, always keep the performance overlay on to see how your changes affect FPS. For now, these are the main 4 to 5 settings I focus on. There are definitely more options in the config file, but since the emulator is still in its early stages, I don't want to overcomplicate things, especially when the results aren't always consistent. Once the emulator becomes more stable, I'll do a deep dive into every setting, covering accuracy, advanced tweaks, and game-specific optimizations. But for now, just tweak these basic settings and experiment.
We've talked about the positives of APS3, but now let's dive into the controversy surrounding this emulator. Like many ambitious projects, APS3 hasn't had the smoothest journey, especially regarding its relationship with open source licensing and community trust. APS3 is based on RPCS3's code, which is allowed under the GPL license, provided the original project is credited and the proper conditions are met. However, concerns arose when the developer initially failed to credit RPCS3. Things became even more questionable when they asked for $5,000 to make the project open source, something that directly violates GPL terms. After community backlash, they lowered the amount to $2,000, but it still raised red flags. More recently, APS3 has moved to a closed testing phase, requiring users to pay for access, further fueling debates about its compliance with open source principles. Another issue involved the on-screen controls. Earlier versions looked strikingly similar to those used in Vita 3K, and the L3R3 button implementation was somewhat unpolished. These concerns, along with licensing violations, led to AS3's GitHub repository being taken down. However, in version 7, the developer introduced new custom controls, addressing some of the criticism. At the start of this video, I mentioned that APS3 is a native PS3 emulator for Android, but that might not be entirely accurate. There's speculation that it could be using Termux to run the ARM version of RPCS3, similar to Olympus PS3, but with a refined front-end and better on-screen controls. This theory was shared by the Sudachi developer, though it remains unconfirmed. Why does all of this matter? Projects like RPCS3 have been developed over years by a dedicated team working for free while also navigating potential legal challenges. If open source projects are used in ways that violate their licenses, it can discourage developers from continuing to share their work with the community, ultimately slowing down progress in emulation. Open source thrives on transparency, proper credit, and collaboration. While APS3 remains a divisive topic, another project, RPCS3 Droid, is gaining traction. This emulator is being developed by Antique Code Jared, known for the Sudachi fork of Yuzu. Unlike APS3, RPCS3 Droid follows the GPL license properly and is expected to be a more transparent alternative. But none of that matters now because the official RPCS3 is finally here after all the drama. Whether this shift is due to a change in philosophy, pressure from projects like APS3, or simply the increasing power of mobile hardware, one thing is certain, it's a major development worth following. From what we've seen of others testing the RPCS3 Android port, its development seems to be progressing steadily. We'd love to make a detailed video on it, but that's something for the future, once it's more stable and we have the time to cover it properly.
This is an exciting time for PS3 emulation on Android. That's all for today's video. We wanted to dive deeper into this emulator, but since it's still in its early stages, we'd rather wait than showcase too many games with graphical glitches on our old tablet. Plus, as we mentioned in our post, we've been pretty busy lately. But don't worry, there's more to come. If you enjoyed this content, consider subscribing for more updates. If you haven't watched the first part of this series yet, you can check it out here. And don't forget to take a look at Violet Emu.
Thanks for watching. This is Kuro and Violet, signing off.